Hi everybody, it's Rishi Agarwal. In today's video, I want to talk about the anatomy of the subclavian artery and its branches. I'm going to start with this drawing to show you some important points, and then we'll move to a CTA, and I'll show you what these structures look like on a real patient. Remember that the right subclavian artery arises from the right brachiocephalic artery, and the right brachiocephalic artery bifurcates about at the level of the right sternoclavicular joint into the right subclavian artery and the right common carotid artery. The left subclavian artery arises directly from the aorta. There are a couple important points about the course of the subclavian arteries themselves. First is that most of the time, neither the right or the left subclavian arteries give off any branches in the mediastinum. Usually the first branches will be in the lower neck. Second is that both the right and left have this little peak that goes slightly above the clavicles for a short segment. This is important because if you're putting in central lines and you see that your line goes above the clavicle, then you may have put it in the artery and not the vein. The subclavian vein stays very close to the clavicle and it doesn't have this little peak that goes above. Third is that anatomically, the subclavian artery is divided into three segments by the anterior scalene muscle, which passes directly anterior to it. So the part medial to the anterior scalene is part one, and the part covered by the anterior scalene is the second part, and the part lateral to the anterior scalene is the third part. Most of the branches come from the first part, but you can also have branches that sometimes come off of the second and third parts. Finally, as the subclavian artery continues lateral to the first rib, it becomes the axillary artery. The axillary artery has many additional branches, which we won't cover in this video. Now let's take a look at the branches of the subclavian artery. The first and largest branch is the vertebral artery. On the left, this can occasionally come from either the aortic arch or from an early branch point of the subclavian artery, but usually it arises just after the subclavian artery exits the thorax. The vertebral arteries ascend in the transverse foramen of the cervical spine and join together to form the basilar artery. There's an important clinical correlation with this anatomy called subclavian steel syndrome. This is when you have a significant stenosis of the proximal part of the subclavian artery that becomes so bad that the flow of blood actually reverses in the vertebral artery. The classic history is that a patient passes out when working out or exercising the affected arm. This increases demand to that arm, and because of the flow reversal, the vertebral artery pulls blood out of the circle of Willis, causing the patient to lose consciousness. So that's subclavian steel syndrome. The next biggest branch of the subclavian artery is the internal thoracic artery, also called the internal mammary artery. This goes inferiorly back into the thorax, and it gives off the anterior intercostal arteries, which anastomose with the posterior intercostal arteries. It continues on inferiorly, just posterior to the costal cartilages, and it divides into the superior epigastric and musculophrenic arteries at about the sixth intercostal space. The thyrocervical trunk arises off of the superior aspect of the subclavian artery, usually at about the same level as the internal thoracic artery, and it gives off many branches, and there can be a lot of variation in those branches, but it almost always terminates in two arteries, the inferior thyroid artery, which gives off branches that go to the thyroid, the parathyroid, the larynx, the esophagus, and the trachea, as well as surrounding muscles. And then the second is the ascending cervical. So these are the two terminal branches of the thyrocervical trunk. The other branches of the thyrocervical trunk are the lateral branches, and these are a lot more variable. These lateral branches are the suprascapular, and the suprascapular is usually the first branch off of the thyrocervical trunk. And then you have the dorsal scapular. And then the last one is the superficial cervical artery. Sometimes you can see these as independent branches from the thyrocervical trunk, but they could also share a common trunk that then bifurcates into the three branches. Or you might see that two share a common trunk and then one arises independently. These can also arise from the subclavian artery itself. and frequently the dorsal scapular artery arises directly from the subclavian. The final branch of the subclavian artery is the costocervical trunk. This divides into two branches, one that goes superiorly, which is the deep cervical. So the deep cervical comes from the costocervical trunk, and the superficial cervical comes from the thyrocervical trunk. And then the branch that goes inferiorly is the supreme intercostal. And remember that the supreme intercostal artery supplies the intercostals for the first and second ribs. All right, now that you have this overview, let's take a look at a patient case. This is a CTA of the head and neck, and we're at the level of the aortic arch here. And if I scroll up, this is the left subclavian artery. So we're going to look at the branches of this person's left subclavian artery. And if you're just starting out, there's a lot of branches and they come off very close to one another. And so it can be very easy to get overwhelmed. So I'm going to show you a little trick, and that's to look at the sagittal images. Because if you look at the sagittal images, it's a lot easier to tell what is what. And I put these little guides up here so you can see where we are in the axial plane. Okay, so if I scroll laterally here, this is the subclavian artery. Now, the first branch and the largest branch to come off is the vertebral artery, okay? And that's it right there. And it usually comes off at about like the 12 o'clock position. If we were to take the subclavian artery and make it into a clock, this comes off at about the 12 o'clock position. Now, let's keep going. We're going laterally now. And the next artery to come off is usually the thyrocervical trunk. And if we were to use that clock analogy, then this would come off somewhere between 9 o'clock and 12 o'clock, somewhere like 10 or 11 o'clock. Okay, so this is the thyrocervical trunk. Now, down here, just below that, between 6 to 9 o'clock, like 7 or 8, this is the internal thoracic artery. Okay, that's the internal thoracic artery. And then the artery that comes off posteriorly here, at maybe 1 or 2 o'clock, that's the costocervical trunk. So if you're having trouble trying to figure out what artery is what, look at the sagittal images because this relationship is very consistent. Now let's look at the axials and we'll have our sagittals up to help guide us. So this I mentioned is the vertebral artery and that arises in the transverse foramen of the cervical spine. Okay, so that's the vertebral artery. Now the next one to come off, this is the thyrocervical trunk. And if we follow that, that terminates in the inferior thyroid artery. So it has this classic hairpin turn here. Actually, let's pull up the coronal images and I'll show that to you. Because the inferior thyroid artery has this classic hairpin turn, and it goes to the inferior aspect of the thyroid gland. And then the next terminal artery, the second to last terminal artery of the thyrocervical trunk is this one right here. And this one is the ascending cervical. And if I triangulate it, you could see it on the axials. There it is. So that's the ascending cervical artery. Okay, and so those are the two terminal branches. And remember I mentioned that there's three lateral branches. So usually the first one that comes off is the suprascapular artery. And let's look at the coronal images to identify that. So this is it right here. This is the suprascapular artery. And if we follow that laterally, it goes off to the scapula. Now, because this is the next CT, we don't have the scapula, but this goes laterally, and if we were to follow it, it would go to the suprascapular notch. And on the axial images, that's it right there. Okay, this is the suprascapular artery right here. The other branch we have to identify is the superficial cervical artery. And if we continue to follow this, you could see that there's a branch that comes off here and it goes laterally. It passes over the anterior scalene muscle And if we follow this artery, it goes posterior here, and it goes deep to the trapezius muscle. So this is the superficial cervical artery. And then I mentioned before that the last branch is the dorsal scapular artery, and sometimes it's hard to find these arteries. So if you start off knowing where it should end up, then that's another way to find it. So the dorsal scapular artery should run medial to the scapula. This is the scapula right here, and this is it. So if we follow this artery back, you could see that this artery arises directly from the subclavian artery. So in this patient, rather than arising from the thyrocervical trunk, it arises from the subclavian artery directly, which is very common. Now, the internal thoracic artery, or the internal mammary artery, as I usually call it, is right here. And you could see that arises just opposite from where the thyrocervical trunk arises, within 1 centimeter of the thyrocervical trunk. Okay, so this is thyrocervical. This is internal thoracic. All right, and that leaves us one last branch, which is the costocervical trunk. And remember, that arises from the posterior aspect of the subclavian artery, and that's it right there. And this is best seen on the sagittal images. So let's pull up the sagittals. So here's the costocervical trunk, and if I triangulate that, that's it right there. And let's just follow it. So this should branch into 2 arteries, and there it is. So it branches into the supreme intercostal. So you can see that this goes below the first rib. This is the first rib right here. And the supreme intercostal is the intercostal blood supply to the first and second ribs. And then this superior branch goes above the first rib, behind the spine, and this is the deep cervical artery. Okay, so the deep cervical artery arises from the costocervical trunk, and the superficial cervical artery arises from the thyrocervical trunk. Okay, and if we continue looking at the subclavian artery, you can see there's no more branches that arise from it. And as we go past this line right here, that's made by the first rib, it becomes the axillary artery. Okay, so this is the axillary artery right here, and this is the subclavian artery right here. All right, so I hope this helps you identify the branches of the subclavian artery. If you have any questions about this topic or any other thoracic radiology topic, let me know in the comments below. Thanks.